Guys, all the things I've been called here to teach you guys tango. So, just want to know how many of you know what tango is? Yeah? It's a dance. From where does it originate? Okay, Argentina. Fantastic. It's a ballroom dancing form. One of my favorite dances. So from Argentina and Uruguay, if I'm not wrong, it originates. And it is very, very tightly tied with sales, remote sales. Because it's a dance wherein it's a very, very close form of dancing. The girl and the guy have to be really, really intertwined with each other, and they have to really dance in a rhythm for it to look nice. Otherwise, the closer you are and the rhythm is not good, you look really, really stupid, right? So, tango is the theme of my talk today. So it takes two to tango, sales and content, and that is what we are going to focus on. We've learned it the hard way. We've seen that you know, over the period, that how sales and marketing they are two divisions that work in silos always. Though theoretically they are supposed to work with each other, but they are always with logger each other. They always you know, they have their own set of goals that they have, and it hurts really, really bad when it comes to remote sales. Why I say that is that in remote sales, the only way that you converse with your prospective customer is through content, and if the content is not in line with what your sales strategy is, it hurts really, really bad. So and hence these two need to really tango with each other. They need to be in harmony with each other. They need to really, really talk the same tone. They need to have the same space when it comes to pitching and stuff like that. And we'll go through that. And hence, much better if you are looking at a remote sales strategy to adopt a cohesive content marketing and a sales team. When it comes to remote sales, I don't want to. I do want to call it out that, you know, it is not that everything can be sold remotely. Right? You need to find your own fitment when it comes to remote sales. Whether the market is conducive to buying remotely, whether your product can be sold remotely, all those fitments you need to first evaluate before we get into remote sales. So it's not a model that will work for every product, so to say. In our case, we've seen and we've researched a bit why Hotelogix, which is a hotel management system on the cloud, which we target towards the small businesses, right? And the subscription is something like $100 a month, so to say. So it's a low low dollar sale, low commitment, so to say. And in my research, it says that, you know, anything which is low dollar, maybe up to $5,000, you can go for it for remote sales if you are able to build the trust. And we'll talk about how to build the trust. So you need to look at whether you can trial experience to the user, whether he can see what you are trying to sell and stuff like that, because he has no face time with you. So he needs to trust at least the product that he's going to buy. So research around the fitment before we get into the applying the sales model. My takeaway from, I don't know, but my takeaway from this whole session is that if I am able to give some kind of a model to people who have who see their fitment in it. That would be my takeaway from this session. And please feel free to make it as interactive as possible during, and just ask questions as and when, and I'll give my best attempt to answer them. So these were the challenges that we are talking about in remote selling. That you don't have the person in front of you. Right? He does not see you, how you look. You are selling into remote countries, maybe remote cities, whatever be the situation. When it comes to remote sales, what becomes very, very important is the way you plan your sales. Which means that today, a lot of people, you know, they just come to my office and they'll say, "Okay, tell me what your requirement is. Tell me something about your company." You can't do this when it comes to remote sales. You get one small chance to talk to that person. You need to be as prepared as possible before you even reach out to him. So for a sales guy, it becomes a lot more challenging environment when it comes to remote sales. Second is that you need to be always talking about him. He, more often than not, most of the remote sales opportunities that you get, at least in the initial phase of your business, are mostly inbound requests that you get based on whatever online marketing you do and stuff like that. And the guy, when he reaches out to you, he's very well researched. He's very well researched on the topic, or he is quite aware when he's talking to you. Second is that you are generally remote sales will be done with the SME market, wherein the operational head, either the owner or the manager of that particular business, is evaluating stuff. So he's an operational expert of his business. So you can't be fooling around with him, right? So the sales guy has to be really, really, he has to research before, he has to study the target customer before he even goes to a meeting. Because all you know, while he's talking, the other guy is yawning and he doesn't even get to know that. That's the problem, right? You don't get to know his body language. A lot of times you change your pitch based on the body language that you have. So at Hotelogix, we adopted a few things. And while we'll be going around these concepts, you know, I'll be exemplifying what we have done to counter that. Number one, we kept a rule in our company that we will not meet any customer. Couple of sales guys resigned. They said, "You know, sir, I am coming to the office. I am passing by this hotel. If I make one visit to that hotel, he will sign up with us." I said, "I don't want that customer." Because the moment they start believing that they cannot sign up a customer without meeting him face to face, remote sales will never work, right? So a few things that we had adopted right from the beginning, at the cost of losing customers, losing salespeople, resigning. They're thinking that these guys are mavericks. They don't want to do business. They just want to splurge some VC-funded money. So there are multiple challenges when it comes to remote sales. But once you get into the groove, it can be you can challenge the world. You can challenge the world because you are sitting at one place, you're building sales force for multiple geographies, you can be as agile as you want. Your cost of sales today, Hotelogix's cost of sales to acquire one customer is $200 versus nearest customer, the cost of sales is minimum $2,500 an account. Now this is the kind of, you know, benefit you can get, and you can really be agile in the market with your strategies. The most important thing when we get into remote sales is to develop trust and be as transparent as you can. The guy is talking, and your most important asset over there is content, actually. So whenever you are talking about yourself, about the product, be as simplistic as possible. Obviously, the tone of content changes based on the geography that you address, but generally need to be as simplistic as possible. Non-pushy, non-sales content really, really helps. A trial, like Hotelogix gives a trial a free trial for them to see the product really helps, giving them as much transparency as possible how life is going to be post becoming a paid customer is very important. At Hotelogix, we point them to third-party sites wherein we have negative comments, reviews also, and positive reviews also. So we try to maintain as much transparency as possible to gain that trust from that person. One more very important thing that I always tell my sales guys is whenever you are on a call, when you come back from that call, you should have told him at least one new thing. Because he starts at the end of the day, he is going to buy it from a salesperson. He has to like that salesperson. So he develops that kind of a respect for that salesperson. When the salesperson tells him something, one thing new that he does not know. So few strategies around that, and even the content has to supplement that, all that sales strategy. And that is where you start gaining their trust and be as transparent as possible. So your most powerful ammunition over here is content. Guys, I seriously see that we've learned it the very hard way. That anyone who wants to get into the lean sales, forget remote sales, wherein you want online marketing to play a big role in it or online approach, invest in content. Invest in content writers day one. Because if we are reaching out to them with content writers which are outsourced, they can never get into the depth of the matter. And without getting into the depth, it is extremely difficult for a highly knowledgeable person to make him respond to it, right? So you're selling again, when you're selling into the SMB market, you're selling it to the operational expert, and he does not respond to things looking at, oh, you know, we do email blast, we are going to increase your sales by 100%, we are going to increase your efficiency by 50%. All these things, you know, he's heard n number of times before, right? So your content needs to be really, really deep. Invest in content day one, because these guys, they take a lot of time to warm up to what your value proposition is and to get into the nuts and bolts of what your offering is. So we began with trust, transparency that we wanted to create. We talked about why content is so important, and let's look at how we can align the content marketing and the sales team. Few very basic things that we do. Number one, they go through the same product training. Number two is that unless and until the content team pass the minimum criteria that is required to pass the product test, they are allowed to write a single piece of it. Second is that sales, they are one who are dealing with customers day in, day out, right? And that's why they have a market. It's very, very important for content team to have a sense of that. So whenever sales gets a customer to Deloitte, the content is asked a lot more questions than what does it. Whenever he publishes that this is my new customer that he's acquired, the content team has to thoroughly go and research about who this is, why has he signed up, this. So the content team has to answer us as to why, what was his problem, why did he sign up with Hotelogix, what is his property, what are the places of attraction nearby. They need to research every bit of it. So they are forced to look into what type of business this is, what type of problems they are facing and stuff like that. In return, the content team today at Hotelogix, they question the sales team. If the sales team, they junk a particular lead that is provided by the marketing team, the marketing team is, they can pull up the sales team. How have you junked this particular lead? So they have that kind of an ownership that we want to develop, that whatever leads you provide, you can ask any damn question that you want to the sales team. Now these may sound very basic, but once you once this starts happening, what happens is that they start getting intertwined with each other. My incentives to my marketing team is not on leads, it's on sales again. So it is in their best interest to get that high quality leads up rank. So few things that we do that force them to intertwine with each other. Similarly, when the sales team, they get leads which are not of that quality, they pull up the marketing team. But it is a joint responsibility to look at as to why this quality of lead is less, is lower than what it is required. Yeah.
Because one is measured on the number of leads,
yeah,
and the salesperson is to convert. So this quality definition, how do you do that?
So basically, at the end of the day, the first level of quality definition is based on the conversions that we get from in the pipeline. So when we look at our pipeline, the first level of conversion we see whether from a lead level to a customer is our conversion fine. Is our conversion based on our expected conversion rate? If that is fine and still the team is complaining, then we look into the micro level conversion as to from prospect to warm, from warm to hot, where is the conversion problem that the team is facing. Based on that, the team has to basically then analyze and come out with an answer as to why this quality problem exists. We clearly specify our target geographies, which are the target geographies that we accept our leads from, which are the target geographies we don't accept. We don't accept leads from China, we don't accept leads from Vietnam. These are the countries who do not buy our system, they only investigate about what's happening. So, so these are the few measures that very, very quantitatively that we try to measure on our quality. So this is the funnel that I wanted to explain, and we'll quickly go through this funnel. So what happens after we do any kind of marketing, the marketing is will produce some kind of response from the market. If the response is from the right target segment, the whole funnel post that is efficient. But if the response is from the wrong target segment, the whole funnel becomes inefficient. So brand positioning becomes extremely critical to have that that funnel to be efficient. Second is that whenever you do any kind of for a remote sales or a remote market environment, your website becomes your main asset where people land up. So your website content strategy again has to tie into your marketing strategy. Second is post when people come out on your website, few will become get into your sales funnel, you will fall out of it, right? So once they get into the sales funnel, the content strategy, that is the content that the sales team also has to use, has to be generated by the content marketing team, by the content team, and it has to basically synchronize with each other, and we'll go into depth of a few of them as we go along. So basically, at the top of the funnel, when they get into the sales funnel, people are researching on your product, so your content has to be more aligned with, did you know kind of mailers and did you know kind of content, giving them product insights. After they get to the warm part of your sales funnel, you have to do some third party validations, some kind of case studies type of material that you have to showcase it to them. So this is what the sales guys do. And when they are really, really hot, what we do is that we do our PR on a very regular basis. 3 to 4 press releases we take out judiciously every month. And what happens naturally is that when a person is at the hot stage of signing up, he tries to Google on your credibility. What is the credibility? And when he sees 10 press releases that are about product updates, that are about signing new resellers, that are about customer acquisitions, the reinforcement happens. And most of the times we are basically doing this reinforcement at the hot level on non-functional areas, support, stability of the company, security and stuff like that. at each stage you'll have people falling out, and for people who fall out, we basically put them into a nurturing program. A nurturing program that we have developed is based on the marketing automation that we put on our website using a tool called HubSpot. There are many other tools in the similar space. So what this does is that if they are into the sales funnel, they basically keep on, it keeps on sending them thought leadership related mailers weekly or bi-weekly or whatever is the rhythm that is appropriate in your target market. People who do not fall into our sales funnel, we basically keep on nurturing them using retargeting. People who become our customers, we nurture them further for upsells and for referrals using our newsletters. So there is a nurturing program that happens. Yeah. So top of the funnel, extremely important that you look into the positioning, whom you are selling to, and the persona, the company that you are selling and the persona of the buyer. Let me give you an example of the company that we are targeting. So in case of Hotelogic, we sell into small and mid-sized hotels. So 5 rooms to 100 rooms. It has to be either a hospitality business or an institute. Our target geography is North America, South America, Southeast Asia. It has to fall into them. More interesting is, this everyone is does by and large. More interesting is the kind of persona study that you have to do, who is your target buyer. When you look into this persona that we do, it is not just about his professional, but also personally, where does he spend his time, right? What is the kind of tone that he that is palatable to him? What are the social media platforms on which he is present? What is the kind of income group does he belong to? What is his age group? It all depends the kind of content that will be palatable to him when you try to market it to him. Website content strategy, extremely important. I'll give you a small example as to what we did for our website content strategy. Me and my other co-founder and an information architect, we went to Goa, stayed in a resort for 3 days in one room. Okay. People thought that there is something illegal happening in this room. Okay. But that room when we came out was full of whiteboard papers all along. And all 3 days that we discussed was what was the information flow that we want the visitor on the website to go through. So how to progressively facilitate him with content that will urge him to take a call to action that we desire. And our objective was to ask him to take a trial of the system. So the content strategy has to make sure that you get the right ones in and keep the wrong ones out. So we clearly say we are a simple system for small and mid-sized hotels. We don't care if a 5-star comes, he gets irritated, gets out of it, no problem, right? But we have kept the persona in mind that it's going to be an owner, he's going to be an educated guy who's going to come. I don't want to teach him what a property management system is, what a hotel management system is. But I want to tell him through my service, what all benefits can I give to him? It's a benefit-driven approach that we take. We drive him to the CTA. We don't leave the CTA on to him to decide what he wants to do in the site. So from various places in the website, the workflow leads to the primary or the secondary CTAs that we want to achieve to generate a lead. Then there are some dynamic portions of a website like your blogs and stuff like that. So on our blogs, basically the strategy is to make sure that it funnels the main website. So when you get people on your blog, your strategy has to be how he can get into your main funnel of your website. So that now he is subjected to the same workflows that people have. After we did this whole approach, and obviously we have automation on our website where we do some lead scoring based on where he visits. So if he visits the pricing page, it's plus 20 points. But if he visits the career page, it's minus 20 points. We know that. So these kind of lead scoring we do. But more importantly, after we did this scientifically, our conversions tripled on our website. Our website before we did this people already say it's a good website. But after this, the conversions really, really increased. Middle of the funnel is where your main focus has to be when it comes to aligning. So as we spoke about in the beginning of the sales cycle, all auto mailers that we send are only about the product, what the product does and stuff like that. I'm so sorry. So it's only about product, just making it transparent to them what all we offer and stuff like that. When it when they get warm, we always facilitate them with the signature itself differ, you know, changes when they send to a warm customer. It just attaches a lot of links to case studies and stuff like that. So we basically use these kind of strategies to make sure that our customer at each stage is facilitated with the information that our content team wants, right? So this is where we do all the interwinding that is required. And no, manually. But what happens is that, see, when you get into the warm stage of us, you know, it becomes slightly indefinite, right? But the signature of my salesperson itself changes. So he has a different template of a signature of a mailer when he sends a mail to a warm lead versus when he sends it to a prospect. So without calling it out, he is able to facilitate that kind of information to the prospective buyer. Sure.
I think you can do more one-on-one, so
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah, I think, I mean, rest of the it is really.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Sure.
Any questions, guys? Let me
My question is, yours is, by the time a prospective customer reaches you, has already done all that research. When that lead comes to you, how well do you know that person? Do you have any kind of way to find out what research has he done, what pages has he navigated? Do you have anything at
No.
all, or do
So
you
if he
go
has
to?
navigated pages on our website, I do have that information. But what research he has done before coming to our website, we don't know. So yes, on our website, and all that input our sales guys have always. Where all has he visited, how much time he spent on the website and stuff like that.
Okay.
What content he has consumed. Yeah. All are here. So I have a English sales team, I have a Spanish sales team, I have a Portuguese sales team, all in Bangalore. And they pretty much sell into almost 83 countries today.
Who are these good content writers? Are they English majors? Are they business majors? Who are they?
So, no, they are not salespeople. These are guys who are these English majors. And who have, I mean, we have three very good content writers in our company. All of them have come from this literature background and stuff like that. They adapt to technology very quick. I mean, they adapt to technology. But the other way around, I have not been successful. I'm not too sure whether, you know, others have seen success in it, but I have not been successful in having such content writers. Earlier, our complete content was outsourced to a company in Chicago, but they just gave us the style, which is correct, but it never gave us the depth. So now we have adopted their style and we have the depth.
What is the software tool that you mentioned which goes to the website? The
HubSpot.
HubSpot.
And there are many others. You know, HubSpot is one of the more expensive ones. There are many others like Marketo and all those. Yeah.
So Aditya, you mentioned HubSpot. My question was around that. It is fairly expensive, but you said you only use it for nurturing your prospects that fall off the funnel, right? Is
that is
that
one of the applications.
But you
Otherwise,
otherwise, because if all your users come in, that becomes super expensive, right? If
no.
all your prospects come in, all the leads come into HubSpot, then that becomes.
No. HubSpot cost will vary only if you are doing outbound. If your outbound mailing list becomes, if that grows. But otherwise, it can do lead scoring for people within the same cost. I mean, we are paying something like $10,000 a year to them. And see, HubSpot kind of tools really help when you have a longer sales cycle, right? So you have to nurture them all the time. You have to measure them, what's happened with them. You know, if they're not in front of you, they suddenly disappear, but they again appear, and you get to know about it. So for us, if a guy has visited 3 times a day, our sales guy has to call them on that particular day for sure.
So yours is a low-touch sales model. So you have, yes. For every sales closure, you require a salesperson to talk?
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay. It's a mission critical system that is running for the hotel, right? So there isn't any closure that we get without a sales intervention.
You said like content is most important. So while creating content, what are the you know factors you measure? Like, do you curate content or you build stories about your business core things?
Both, right? So you have to do thought leadership content versus you have to give content stories about your own customers and stuff like that.
Yes, you go either too technically about your business solutions or you just
Tracks we take. So okay. we go technical. So let's say we are publishing 8 blogs. A month. One of them will be highly technical on the product,
okay,
right? But one of them will be story driven, right? But again, the content that we publish, it gets republished and re-presented based on the geography. So, like in US, you can't say Mr. John, but okay. Maybe in UK, if you don't say Mr. John, it's offensive, right? So, all those small little tweaks that we do. And I'll be happy to mail this presentation across because it mentions what we do as regional specific.
Yeah, I think it's a good talk here, and I see a lot of interesting Q&A. So Aditya is around. If you have any queries, further queries, he's going to happy to answer you or have a one-to-one session and all that. So I think taking the time into account, we'll have to move on to the next session. And wonderful having him here.
Thank you.
Thanks.
No, not
thank you. Thank you.